Okay, hey everyone. The name is Erik Thor, and today I have a special guest. Today I'm guested by Joyce Meng, and Joyce is known for doing a lot of in-depth interviews that really showcase the differences inside and between the different personality types. And I'm going to share a link down below so you can check out her channel at the end of this interview. And I really recommend looking at her different interviews if you want to explore the different types in practice and see how different people experience being different personality types. Okay, so today we are going to be discussing not just the INFJ flow state, Zen state, the work of Linda Behrens, interaction styles, self-transcendence. We're also going to discuss personas, personal growth, and why that's so hard and what we can do. I hope you're all going to enjoy this discussion together with me and Joyce. Now, first of all, I want to say I really liked the conversation we had last week, where we just talked and discussed ideas and discussed different systems. I noticed, like, when I was talking to you already then, that you're really good at making people feel seen and putting people at ease. And it feels like you're a great listener. So this is also something I've seen when you interview the different personality types. I was wondering, does that just come naturally to you, or is that something you aspire to or worked hard on?
I'm pretty good at smoothing things over with people, but I find the element of getting used to being with a lot of people all the time. Like, I do panels sometimes of 9 to 10 people, and that has been something that I've grown used to. Yeah. But I really enjoy being the facilitator because I'm able to make sure that we're able to take a steady path towards the goal that we're aiming for. So that relates to the series that I did recently about Linda Behrens' interaction style. And it allows me to use my skill of charting the course, as Linda puts it, to help people with guiding the conversation along so that we don't get caught up in tangent land indefinitely.
And so you mentioned it already a little bit, but you studied with Linda Behrens. So I was wondering, what do you think the psychology community can learn from her and from her work?
Yeah, so Linda Behrens has this really interesting concept of interaction styles, and she posits that there are 4 types of interaction styles that all the 16 types fit into. And I think it's a really cool add-on to type, and it'll help people type themselves as well if they're able to identify that the way that they interact with other people. Linda's also coming up with another theory that's going to be released soon, and it's almost like the Socionics quadrants. So she's dividing the types by functions. Okay. And so it's going to be really cool. And so this is something that the type community could use more of. Although Linda typically presents at the APTs, so the Association of Psychological Type. So not a lot of the younger community of typology knows about her, unless it's through C.S. Joseph and his typing grid, which uses Linda's interaction styles. And so I think a lot of people could learn concepts from Linda, such as be like me and be like them syndrome. So what this means is that sometimes when we treat other people a certain way, we expect them to either be like us. So it's when your parents want you to act a little bit more like them, that's a be like me syndrome. Yeah. And then there's also be like them syndrome, where you feel like you have to be like someone else and you have to change yourself to fit in. And I think those concepts are really, really fascinating because they show why type is important. So you don't have to try to make other people more like you, or you don't try to make yourself more like other people. And I find that exquisite because a lot of people spend their lives feeling like they have to be someone they're not, or forcing others to fit into their box. So it helps us not put our loved ones or people we meet into our box of what they should be like. And it allows for more freedom, more fluidity, and for people to be in their flow state. And because if you keep trying to get someone to be like you, what will happen is they'll slowly but surely feel a little bit dead inside. So over time, they're like, I can't be myself. And even if you don't admit it to yourself, you will feel a little bit more dead inside. Just slowly, it'll chip away at you. And so your sense of aliveness will be taken away from you. And yeah. So I find Linda Behrens concepts are very good at recultivating your sense of aliveness through understanding how you diminish your own flow state. Yeah. You don't allow yourself to be you. And that causes things like dysthymia, depression, anxiety. Those things can be genetic, of course, but sometimes they're caused by our environment too. And that's from not being able to use the things that come most naturally to you. Mm. Almost if someone is right-handed or left-handed is a better example, and they're taught to be right-handed their whole life. Some people are okay with it and they're totally fine with it. Other people, they have severe trauma around that. Yeah. And so type and Linda Behrens, how she views it, is able to expand our way of seeing type and help us resolve the innerness that we deal with on a regular basis as human beings.
Yeah, I'm really happy with so many things you mentioned in that approach. First of all, my viewers will know that the flow state and the nurturing that is one of the key goals of my channel and why I do what I do. I've always wanted to help people realize their best version of themselves. And I found that there is a term in Jung's work that is really important that people keep forgetting about. And that is psychic energy, basically. Like, that's what nurtures like and gives us a sense of aliveness. When we are living under the oppression of the persona, or constantly trying to fit a certain role, or trying to fit in with other people, we are chipping away at our energy and causing ourselves stress. So what you say about that, you know, when you notice that the person around you is not like letting you be yourself, and when you notice a person like a parent or somebody, you know, is constantly trying to get you to fit into a role, or they get angry or they get upset whenever you go outside of that role, it makes you feel smaller and smaller over time, because you become more and more limited as a person. And the ego like cannot be this very small thing. Like, we have to be multifaceted people. So something that I've come to realize lately about this is that you know, relationships between people is almost like a chemical interaction, in a sense. Like and so it feels like some personality types are better at helping us facilitate and come to our own. So I was going to ask you, which personality types do you feel really help you be yourself and give you space to do things your way?
That is a good question. I would say anyone who's mature and healthy can, of course, do that regardless of their personality type.
Yeah.
I would say with ENFJs, they've helped me the most with that because they have the same functions as me, but they're able to use their FE and SE better than I can. Mm. And so they play the role of role model, and they're very supportive and reassuring and willing to let me make mistakes too. I find with the ones that I'm close with, and I find ENFPs also help me with the self-development of my soul or my psyche. And they do that by bringing me out of my shell constantly. And a lot of the ENFPs I know, they don't really have walls for the people that they care about. Mm. And so oftentimes they'll come into the relationship with their whole, like, with no protection, and they'll just kind of embrace you with full arms. And that kind of intensity and that kind of raw vulnerability and that kind of enthusiasm that they bring is really able to break through some of my reserved and privateness and bring me more into the world.
Hmm. I noticed that I thought about it lately, that sometimes I have what you say, old hermit syndrome almost, which is like, I tend to believe that I can kind of shield myself off from the world and kind of find enlightenment on my own. And I was, you know, reading through some of Carl Jung's books lately, like Ion, for example, and he was talking about like, it's not possible to reach enlightenment by going up on Mount Everest and sitting there and thinking. He is very clear on that we need other people to facilitate growth and to get us to become something more than what we already are. I've noticed that, you know, I've especially noticed lately that personal growth is something very important for all the personality types. And it's something that people are really struggling to do. Like, it's very difficult for people to grow. Like, people want to grow and they are constantly working on and putting effort into growing, but they don't know really how to break out of the script that they can have sometimes. Like, if you are an INFJ and you have this like way of functioning, which is like, oh, I'll do things myself and I'll focus on everyone else's needs and I'll keep forgetting about my own needs, you know, like, what can an INFJ do, for example, to actually grow, to actually get out of that script, or to, if should they get out of the script, what can they do about it?
Yeah, one of the things that I do to get out of my script is thinking if the thing that you're doing is in your best interests. So asking yourself the question, is the action I'm about to do in my best interests in the long run? And if it's not, then to not do it, is it going to be good for your future self? So using your introverted intuition to see and forecast, if I keep doing this thing that I'm doing, am I going to resent myself or other people for it later? Resentment is typically a sign that you've overstepped your boundaries. So if you've not paid attention to your boundaries and you've disrespected them, it will manifest in the form of resentment, because you'll be feeling a core sense of anger over not taking care of yourself. Mm-hmm. And so asking yourself, will doing this create any form of resentment for myself, is an indication if you're doing something outside of your what you would like to do.
So I see something in your answer, because something that I've come to notice is that our personal reason is very limited. Like, we can use logic or reason to rationalize any form of action to do a certain thing. But I think if we only go by based on reason, we can't really grow, because then we only repeat what we already know over and over in a spiral, in a sense. But what you are doing, what I see doing, is you talk about your higher self. And you know, the thing about your higher self is your higher self, it does not really exist except more in like a metaphorical sense, or like as a like almost unconscious drive. So it sounds like you are like pulling into something more than what you are, and you are somehow able to get an idea of or to see into or think that you have something more to yourself or something than what you already are, and to trust that.
Yeah. Sometimes being able to set boundaries is being able to tap into your higher self, because you're not dictated by the pulls of other people's needs in the moment, but you're able to have something that's able to ground you into yourself. Mm-hmm. And I find what you said about Carl Jung is so true, that growing requires a community, it really accelerates growth. You don't need it, but it accelerates it. You go exponentially faster when you grow with other people, because they bring new perspectives, they bring a diverse way of seeing things or healing. And I find my best form of transcendence is done in mutual transcendence. Yeah. And so I love that state of growing with people that are on a similar type of path as you, or have something to contribute to your path, even if they're on a different path. It gets you out of your silo, because I think one of the things that restrict from people from growing the most is staying within their silo by accident. And you don't know you're doing that unless you're with other people who can show you how much you've been in your own head and obsessing over yourself rather than being outside of your head and thinking a little bigger. Like, I don't notice when I'm doing it. So everyone else is the same way as well. And so it's great to have other people knock you out of your own brain, because our natural defaults when we're feeling at our lower self state is to be in our head and you don't even know it. It's like a fish swimming in water. Yeah. A fish doesn't know it's swimming in water, just like a person doesn't know when they're thinking about themselves and actually limiting themselves by accident by being too much in their own head.
Yeah, it's kind of like when they say that like a cat gets injured, the cat will pull away from everyone, and so instead of going for help, they will kind of retreat to themselves in a sense. And sometimes I see people have that same thing. You know, if you feel injured or if you feel like you're struggling or going through a rough time, you feel like you can't be around other people because you feel often, I think, that you have to be so positive and that you always have to show a certain energy to the world and be a certain person. And if you can't be that person for the world, or if you feel too tired, then you start isolating yourself. And that's really dangerous. That's when we need people the most.
Yeah, it's quite ironic how people tend to isolate themselves when they need people the most.
Yeah.
It's almost like during the periods where you need someone to hold your shame or to hold your hurt and to be a witness to you is the moment it feels the most intoxicating to retreat into yourself and isolate.
Yeah.
There's a paradox.
There's a reason for this as well. I know an INFP friend, she shared a quote recently, and it was that personal growth can sometimes feel like trying to baptize a cat. So, you know, like trying to put them in the bathtub and they really don't want to go in there. And they're like, no, get me out. and that's often in those states when we feel the most fear or the most shame or the most self-blame or whatever we feel, you know, it's the most important to remember that all those feelings that I feel right now are just information. Like they're not things that I should act on or go continue down. Like they're more like there to tell me that I'm struggling right now. Oh yeah, I'm struggling. I'm feeling anger. I'm feeling sad. I'm feeling ashamed. So I need to do something. I need to baptize myself.
Baptize your inner cat.
Yes, exactly. I had another question for you, and it's what do you think is the main quest of the INFJ personality type? Is there one?
Their main quests, there are a lot of them, and it depends on the individual too.
Yeah.
I find INFJs to be a great well of deep insight and far-reaching foresight. And it's just hard to sometimes find people in which you can see on the same wavelength. So a part of the quest is finding people who speak your language so you don't have to spend a lifetime translating your soul. Because INFJs, they can have all of this thoughts on the universe or about life or about people and about how people work and tick, but they don't really have anyone to disclose it to and to be this guide or this, I don't know, this person with these thoughts or this person with these ideas about life, and they don't really have a place to actualize them or a place where people always take it completely seriously or a place where they can feel less alien. So a part of the INFJ quest is finding your tribe, because oftentimes INFJs can feel misunderstood and that they're not like most people. And so a part of the quest is finding their groupies, their chosen family throughout life that do get them and can encourage them to reach their highest potential. So I believe that to reach our highest self, sometimes it's easier to have someone who sees our higher self and to encourage us to be that. Because sometimes we might not even be aware that that option is there until someone illuminates that that exists. And so a part of the INFJ quest is finding your higher self and believing in it and going for it. And it can be difficult because with the SE in the inferior slot, you might not have the pretense to want to actualize your visions as much, but the quest of the INFJ is you have all these brilliant thoughts about life. Now, how are you going to bring it forth and manifest it into the world and put it into the world so that people can see all of the wonderful insights, ideas, and perspective you have on reality and the long-term implications and the underlying meaning of things, instead of just keeping it to yourself. And so I find INFJs sometimes struggle with sizzling. They're all steak, and sometimes they need to learn to sizzle too, because it's the extroverted sensing that is the sizzling. And so that's learned over time. how to refine your presentation so you can bring forth all the wonderful things within your mind. Oftentimes, I find a lot of INFJs, they have beautiful, beautiful mindscapes. And if you get to know one, their mind is like an aphrodisiac and their soul is so, so full. And they just need to tell people about it or just bring forth their insights so people can benefit from it, because there's a lot of wisdom there to be unpacked that often goes untapped, almost like a gold mine that hasn't been mined for gold. It's so much potential there.
I really like the metaphors you were bringing in. I was wondering about the sizzling metaphor. Do you mean like to sizzle, like to let yourself be uncomfortable in the world, or how do you feel with that? Or how do you mean with that?
Yeah, that's a component of it for sure. Being okay to embarrass yourself and doing it for a higher purpose. And the sizzling is also letting yourself shine a bit, letting yourself be a little bit sparkly so that people notice you,
right?
And people see you. Right. So that you can be a lighthouse and that people can see your shine and that they can be drawn to it. You have to shine your light in order for people to notice the lighthouse. So if you always turn off your lighthouse, then the boats won't know where to go to find you.
Yeah.
But as an INFJ, as long as you are able to articulate your wonderful thoughts about humanity or whatever it is that you're deeply, deeply passionate about, it's to go into that and to bring it forth into the world. So it's not just a you thing. If it's a treasure chest, you can share the treasure with the world instead of keeping all of the gold to yourself.
I'm really enjoying listening to you. I find that you use so many, for example, the lighthouse metaphor is one that I've also used many times. Something that I notice when I look at older, more healthy INFJs is that they have this naturally whimsical nature. They are a little bit playful. They look at the world as a kind of absurd chaos in a sense, and they themselves see themselves as they're just naturally wise in a sense. They have this ability to kind of gain insight into things they should not know. But at the same time, they have this trust that even if I have these answers, I know that the world is chaos. And so I'm always open to keep an open eye and to look at things from new perspectives and to keep learning from things. What I see with unhealthy INFJs, it's that they get attached to one way of seeing things or get stuck in one vision to the point where it almost becomes a nightmare almost. And I see Asura Saiki made a video about it a while back, that many INFJs struggle from kind of the Cassandra complex, which is just that many INFJs, they feel like they have or know what is going to happen in the future, or they know things that could be of help to the world, but they don't feel like they will be taken seriously. So most of the time they don't dare to share anything. And often the deepest trauma for the INFJ is to be misunderstood or to not be listened to or to be shut down when you are telling people something and they don't want to see it. So how can people deal with things like that?
It's to ask why questions instead of shutting down the INFJ. So if the INFJ, they'll moderate. So they'll tell you a part of what they're seeing and what they know, and they're seeing if you'll receive it well. And so a way to encourage an INFJ to share is to, instead of shutting down the conversation, it's to actually probe and ask, oh, why do you think that? What led you to that insight? So being inquisitive instead of judgmental, because sometimes it can sound a little bit woo-woo. So to have someone reassure you that it's okay to speak your perspective is important.
Yeah. It's, I think, really comes down to the mindset of the people you're talking to, and also just letting people know like kind of what you need from our conversation, and also so that they understand your point of view. Because if you are sharing an idea or some new insight, a lot of time it's uncooked steak, to go back to that analogy, in a sense. Like it's something you have not tested yet. It's not something that you have confirmed through evidence. It's something that you have noticed, or something that you feel might be the case. And so people, the best kind of people are often the people that are open-minded, to the sense that they can see, okay, that's interesting. Like that they don't go immediately to what's the proof of that. But what that's interesting, if that's true, how would that be true? That kind of a process, I think, is very helpful for INFJs.
I would agree.
Now, I was gonna ask you about the flow state, because Dario Nardi has this theory that when he studied the INFJ brain, you're probably aware of this, he found that INFJs had a special way of using their brain, which involved kind of using all areas of the brain together, all at a kind of a similar rate when engaged with one activity. And he called this kind of the brain being kind of in zen, like everything being in harmony with everything. So I was going to ask, how do you experience the INFJ flow state? Would you say zen is flow for an INFJ?
Yeah, it sounds about right. It's a holistic use of your brain. I find intuitive functions in general are very holistic. Like Dario Nardi, he says with extroverted intuition, he calls it Christmas tree lighting. So it's the whole brain too, but it's sporadic, and it's more like it's lighting up more at a rapid pace. Yeah. Whereas for the INFJ brain, it's similar, but it's slowly. It's a zen process of using your whole brain. So it's a melding almost. And I find I'm using it all the time because I always feel like I'm in a state of meditation. I feel like I don't have to go into a sensory deprivation tank because my existence is a sensory deprivation tank. And so oftentimes I can feel like in the background I'm processing something, and after a while I'll see the image clearly and I'll have the insight, and it's from this pressure cooker in my brain, and it's molding all of those insights in a zen state into this well formulated thought or idea. So that's how it feels like to be in my mind. I just feel like I'm in a constant state of meditation.
I feel the same way. I've called myself naturally meditative many times. I started going to Buddhist courses when I was a kid to try it out. But then I found when they taught it to me, I was like, I'm already doing this. I would be, for me, it would be so normal to just sit and just let my mind go completely empty, and to just like let my unconscious work, in a sense. And I would know that if I would just, like, often what I would do is a little bit of sensory deprivation. Like if I was in a group and we had to come up with an idea, I would go out of the room and I would go into a dark room and just tune out of everything and just be completely quiet. And then after a few minutes or so, I would come back into a room and I would feel like, okay, there we go. Now I know what to do. Now I have an idea in my head. Now, I was going to ask, this is more of a funny question, but it's, I've noticed that I use music to help this flow state, in a sense, a lot. So I found myself really putting on different lists depending on what kind of mood I want to be in, but really also just using, especially, what should you say, lo-fi, jazz, or classical music. And if I can have a list like that on, I can be focused on a task for almost an infinite amount of time. If I'm enjoying it and it's interesting to me, I can just keep working on it forever. Do you use music like that?
Yeah, sometimes I do. Yeah. And it's therapeutic and nice. I also would add in, with the Asian upbringing, I have a lot of anime music in my playlist too on top of that. So music definitely helps put you in a state to do things. Sometimes I'll have shows playing too that I've, yeah, that I'll play while doing stuff. Yeah.
Like TV shows or podcasts or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fair enough. We've almost run through all my questions, but I had one that I wanted to end this with, and it's what does self-transcendence mean to you?
Self-transcendence is mutual transcendence. I have an interview with an ESTP recently, and his motto for his life is improve in all ways, always, which is a really great saying. And there's also the saying purpose first. And so I find what these share in common is placing growth above all else. And I find that transcendence is a state in which you prioritize your growth. And at some level, you are bored or not able to deal with stagnancy anymore. And it's a frustration with staying stagnant or complacent or the same. Mm-hmm. And it results in this desire to grow. Or if you have a situation that gives you a necessity to grow, I would argue that your whole life kind of gives you a necessity to grow, because there's going to be something that heads your way in life that is going to be so overwhelming one day that you're going to have trouble dealing with. Life is overwhelmingly painful, and for some people, or just for everyone, we have something happen that is just completely devastating and horrific. And so I find growth is necessary to deal with all of that suffering. It's finding a purpose that makes all the suffering worth it in life. Yeah. Because you're going to suffer. So what makes it worth it? And I find that self-transcendence is being able to find a purpose worth living for despite the suffering. So beauty is given at the cost of pain is kind of how I see it.
Yeah.
So self-transcendence is finding a beauty so gorgeous that it's worth all the pain that life brings. And I bring it back to the concept of mutual transcendence, because I find transcending sometimes requires other people too. The most revolutionary moments I've had with my own personal growth have been sparked by other people.
Yeah,
same. So people really serve as great tinder, even if they don't give the full insight, they give like that little piece you need to ignite your own mind.
Yeah.
And so everything is good fuel or ignition to help you understand your transcendence more. So everything is either a guide or a distraction towards your ultimate transcendence. And it's like figuring out, what are the distractions and unlearning those or trying to use less of those? And what are guiding you more towards who you're meant to be and the things that light you up and make you feel more alive?
Yeah.
The reason why I emphasize feeling alive is I think it's a state very few people feel. And yet it's the number one thing that is one of the biggest life forces for wanting to be alive, is that feeling of aliveness. And so that's why I love type, because I think it's a way to transcend yourself.
Yeah.
Because by being more in the functions that you prefer, you're able to catalyze yourself and your own potential, and you're able to become the person you were meant to be by allowing yourself and giving yourself permission to grow into the best version of you.
Yeah. There is a saying I have, which comes to, it has to do with suffering. And for me, it's, I find that people can get lost on what is their higher cause, what is their higher goal in life. Like we can get so attached to things, and sometimes we get attached to the wrong things. Like we might think that, oh, I have to get more likes on my social media posts. So we focus on rather the outcome, like, oh, I want to be happy, or I want to feel pride, or I want to get this emotional kick or this rush of dopamine or whatever it is. You know, we focus on the emotional reward very much, forgetting that everything has a price, and understanding that emotions are two sides of the same coin, that the suffering is going to happen to all of us, just as happiness. So the real question is, and what we really have to tune into, what I tend to see is the higher good is our values and our virtues in life, our purpose. It can be like being a good person. It can mean being and having love. It can mean achievement in the sense of being able to accomplish something amazing. And it's important to remember why we do things. Do I do it for the quick satisfaction, or just to win, or just to prove something? Or am I doing it because I want to make the world a better place, or I want to make my life better, or I want to help my friends? You know, like, learn to think about and find the difference between those drives, I think, is key, because emotions are tricky and hard to hold on to.
They very much are. Something I've been emphasizing a little more has been a state of effortlessness. So you can do a lot of work, but it can feel effortless if it's the right kind of thing and it's within the things that you love and that are natural for you and comfortable for you. For instance, I can give a story from my own life to illustrate. Back a few years ago, I was depressed and I would wake up around 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. And I found it really hard to wake up, and I had a 9-to-5 job and it was really hard to wake up then. And it felt like my organs were dying every time I was waking up at like 7 for my job. And I realized that after I started doing things that were more in my flow state and doing things that I really enjoyed and made me fundamentally happy, my depression cleared up. And I started waking up at 8 a.m. every morning naturally. I didn't have to set an alarm. I didn't have to do anything. It's just by being in your flow state, you are able to cure a natural sort of fatigue you have going through the world. And it is very curative.
Yeah.
It's medicine to be more in your flow state.
It really is. I think healing is the act of living your best life and trying to live your best life and trying to have good experiences. And in that, you know, like you get the chance and opportunity to feel better and work through things and to, feel better. And I, like, for me, it would be like if I was having a bad day, I would ask if a friend needed help with something, because it would be like an opportunity for me in a sense. By being able to help that person, I would get perspective on what they are going through. And at the same time, I would get the chance to kind of work through my own problem and connect with them and to share. And it would be like a mutual thing where you both get to help each other in a sense. And that for me was very rewarding. Now, I want to say I really appreciated having this conversation with you today. And I want to say thank you so much for joining in and for sharing your thoughts and experiences. And I was going to ask, before we end this up, do you have any projects going on right now or any upcoming videos or anything you want to tell the world about?
I do. I have a book coming up next year. And in this book, it is my theory on typology.
Wow.
And it's going to be illustrating the viewpoints of type from different systems that I use in my own practice,
right,
as well as my own theory on type as well, compounded into that. And this book, the mission of it is to feel like a hug. So when you read it, it's meant to embrace the viewers or whoever's reading it and make them feel seen, heard, and it is also meant to be a more emotionally touching book too. So a lot of typology books are a little, and my goal with this book is to make it warm and fuzzy. So it kind of gets to your soft spots a little bit. as well. I have a few other projects coming up as well. I want to create this book series with a bunch of descriptions written by people of the types. So because of type talks, I've met a lot of people of different types. Mm-hmm. And so what we're planning to do together is to crowdsource type definitions or type descriptions written by and releasing that. So it gives a more holistic, more true to the type feel of the types because it's written by people of the types. And it's my belief that people should be given the chance to speak for themselves. Yeah. And so I'm really passionate about giving people a platform where they can describe their own type and perhaps we can make it a little bit more accessible and spread out those written by type descriptions of the type. That is my hope. I'm also planning to speak at the Association of Psychological Types a little bit more. So you'll see me more at APT events. And that's basically it.
Wow. Okay. Busy schedule. Thanks again for joining in. Don't forget to check out Joyce's channel down below. And what were your thoughts on this discussion? I hope you had as fun as we did. And hope to see you all in the next video.